Today's reading has three stories, and it's the last one that gets the greatest billing, Jesus' lament over Jerusalem. However, we need to understand the first two stories and how they fit into Luke's gospel to see more deeply the words of conflict that are directed towards Herod, or to see more deeply even the mother hen imagery that Jesus uses. We often want to hold on to the soft and pastoral side of Jesus, you know, the side that welcomed children into his ministry and extolled them as models of how one comes to receive God. However, today's reading seems to be in stark opposition to that type of imagery of Jesus. Repent or perish. That really doesn't leave much wiggle room. And it gets even tighter if we look back at the stories that are before this one, as they are about division and judgment. After the story of repent and perish, we move into the parable of the barren fig tree. We know that parables are supposed to teach us something about God's realm. So what is it that we are to learn about God's realm through this story? We hear this in verse 9. If it bears fruit next year, well and good, but if not, you can cut it down. It's the ending of the parable about the barren fig tree. Are we to learn that God is just going to give us one more year? I certainly hope not. I've been alive for 52, a Christian for 45, ordained for 24, and the pastor of Holy Cross for 13. There are days that I don't bear much fruit in any of those areas. There are also days that I do. But if I've only got one more year to get it all right, well, that's not going to happen. I'm going to continue to have days that do not bear fruit and days that will. Are we to learn who is who in this story? Are we to learn, as has been traditionally taught, that God is the man who planted the fig tree and Jesus is the gardener who intercedes, and that we are the tree? Well, if that's the case, I really don't want Jesus bringing more manure into the roots of my existence. I can get into enough trouble and enough manure in my life on my own. We come to this last part of the reading with these unanswered questions, and somehow they're supposed to help us understand these harsh words to Herod and understand the mother hen imagery even more deeply. While we don't like it, Jesus makes demands on people. We saw that last week. We're to go out of our way to help others and to be generous with people who might be considered our enemies. We're to take up extra work if that means others are freed up to live out their call. Now, you could see that as unfair. And I'd say it's how life is when we understand community in the way that God does. It's not done to the extent that it's martyrdom and we parade how much we've given up or how generous we are or how much extra work we took on for someone else. It's about working together in community to allow the work of God to happen. And what is this work of God? Well, I think it gets expressed well in the middle of verse 34. How often have I desired to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings? How often? Not once. Not seven times. Not seven times 70. How often? To me, that implies a continual longing on the part of Jesus, a continual longing on the part of our God to provide protection for us so that we can grow, so that we can develop. So yes, there is lament over Jerusalem, and Jerusalem is judged with some harsh words. However, all of that is to lead us to these verses of God's purpose, for us to be cultivated into bearing God's fruit in the world, of protecting us so that we can grow and develop. For none of us gets it right every day, and our God is standing there, desiring to be with us, protecting us, helping us show the world more clearly the image of God that is within us. And for that, we give thanks. Amen.